The notorious Say's Law was formulated by Jean-Baptiste Say, a French economist, who was the first one to state the law in a systematic manner. The law is popularly known as the Law of Markets. Briefly stated, this law means that supply always creates its own demand. In other words, according to J.B. Say, there cannot be general overproduction or general unemployment on account of the excessive supply over demand, because whatever is supplied or produced is automatically exchanged for money. In an exchange economy, whatever is produced represents the demand for another product, because whatever is produced is easily sold. Whenever additional production takes place in the economy, necessary purchasing power is also generated concurrently to absorb the additional supply. Hence, there is no scope of supply exceeding demand and causing unemployment. This law was the basis of their assumption of full employment in the economy, which rested on the plea that income is spent automatically at a rate which will always keep the resources fully employed. Say believed that people did not work for its own sake, but to obtain other goods and services that go to satisfy their wants. To be employed simply meant to work in a field or to start a shop and to sell one's own product in the market. The organization of the economy was simple, under which people spent on tools and consumer goods. Saving and investment were not separate processes. W.H. Hutt once referred to Say's law as the most fundamental economic law in all economic theory. In its crude and colloquial form, Say's law is frequently understood as supply creates its own demand, as if the simple act of supplying some goods or services on the market was sufficient to call forth demand for that product. It is certainly true that producers can undertake expenses, such as advertising, to persuade people to purchase a good that they have already chosen to supply, but that is not the same as saying that an act of supply necessarily creates demand for the good in question. This understanding of the law is obviously nonsensical, as numerous business and product failures can attest to. If Say's law was true in its colloquial sense, then we would all get wealthy just by producing whatever we wanted. If we want to get a more accurate understanding of Say's law, perhaps we should consult what Say himself had to say about his supposed law. In the passage where he gets at the insight behind the notion that supply creates its own demand, Say writes, "It is production which opens a demand for products. Thus, the mere circumstance of the creation of one product immediately opens a vent for other products." Put another way, Say was making the claim that production is a source of demand. One's ability to demand goods and services from others derives from the income produced by one's own acts of production. Wealth is created by production, not by consumption. My ability to demand food, clothing, and shelter derives from the productivity of my labor or my non-labor assets. The higher or lower that productivity, the higher or lower is my power to demand. Say's law has nothing to do with an equilibrium between aggregate supply and aggregate demand, but rather it describes the process by which supplies in general are turned into demands in general. It is always the level of production which determines the ability to demand. Say believed that during the process of production, necessary purchasing power is generated which absorbs the additional supply. For example, when a new car is manufactured, necessary purchasing power is simultaneously generated in the form of wages, profits, etc., so that the car is used. Hence, there is no possibility of the aggregate demand becoming deficient. He no doubt admitted that supply of a particular commodity may exceed its demand temporarily on account of the wrong calculations of businessmen, but general overproduction and hence general unemployment is impossible. He admitted that specific commodities might be overproduced, but a general glut in the sense of a general depression was unthinkable, for the very process of production created the required effective demand necessary to absorb total output. If, however, due to some mistake, overproduction comes to exist in respect of a particular industry, it will be corrected automatically when businessmen suffer losses and switch over from the production of goods they cannot sell to the production of goods they can sell. Say was supported in his view by Ricardo and Mill, for they also held a view that a general glut of the market could not occur. Because all market exchanges are of goods or services for money, all markets are money markets, and the only way there can be an excess supply or demand for goods is if there's an opposite excess supply or demand for money. Take the more obvious case of a glut of goods, such as one might find in a recession. Say's law, properly understood, suggests that the explanation for an excess supply of goods is an excess demand for money. Goods are going unsold because buyers cannot get their hands on the money they need to buy them despite being potentially productive suppliers of labor. Conversely, a general shortage or excess demand for goods can only arise if there is an excess supply of the thing goods trade against, which can only be money. Recessions and inflations are, therefore, fundamentally monetary phenomena, as Say's law points us in the direction of looking at what is going on in the production of money to explain the breakdown of the translation process of production into demand. The orthodox statement as enunciated above is based more or less on the following assumptions. That the free enterprise system based on price mechanisms provides a place for growing population and an increase in capital. In an expanding economy, new firms and workers find their way into the productive process not by displacing others, but by offering their own products in exchange. The extent of the market is not limited, that is, incapable of expansion. The extent of the market is as big as the volume of products offered in exchange. No necessity on the part of the government to intervene in business matters so that the attainment of automatic adjustment is facilitated. Flexibility of interest rates and long period were considered essential for its successful working. According to Say's law of markets, there is an automatic adjustment in the economy as whatever is produced is consumed. In other words, every output brings along with it the necessary purchasing power in circulation, which will lead to its sale. So there is no overproduction. Hence, there is no necessity on the part of the government to intervene in business matters, as that will enter conflict with the automatic adjustment mechanism of Say's law of markets. According to Say's law, increasing production will naturally result in proportionate increases in demand. The clear implication of this assumption is that, if you're aiming to facilitate economic growth, it's much more effective to focus on increasing production than increasing demand. After all, production is much easier to control and spontaneously generate than demand. And increasing production will itself increase demand, resulting in higher rates of economic growth and, on a national scale, a higher gross domestic product. Say's law also has strong implications for what governments ought to do in the sphere of economic policy. Rather than adhering to mercantilist policies, which are based on the belief that money is the foundation of wealth, Say's law makes a stronger case for laissez-faire economics. Wages and also prices are not flexibly consequence-free. Workers will undermine efforts to lower their wages. High levels of savings, when people and businesses hoard money, mean lower consumption. They may do so due to low economic confidence in the prospect of spending. Liquidity traps involve spending demand being outweighed by the demand to hold on to cash. The result, bank reserves increase along with savings rates so that the total demand throughout an economy declines. From the points enumerated above, it is clear beyond doubt that whatever force Say's law had during barter economy, it certainly does not hold true of modern conditions. It has been completely given up by modern economists in their theoretical and practical work on money and business cycles. Under barter economy, where production was primarily for consumption, namely, whatever was produced was exchanged for goods and services. Say's law had some meaning, however, today, when the production is based on future expectations and anticipations of demand, it has little validity, as there is bound to be some overproduction, resulting in some type of glut in the market. Viewed, however, as a broad generalization in micro-context, Say's law presents in a greater measure a picture of the exchange economy, where new firms and workers find their way into the productive process by offering their own products in exchange. Even today, we know that the law is true to the extent production creates its own demand via payment to the factors of production and their resulting consumption. That was all for this video. Thank you for watching. Do like, share, and subscribe to our channel Explified. Check out our channel for more interesting content.